behalf of the Center for Economic Policy and Public Finance, a warm welcome to all of you on the second day of the International Conference on Public Finance, Theory, Practice and Challenges. We have an interesting set of lectures lined up for the day. We look forward to your enthusiastic participation. As we begin the day's program, may I request Sri Sanjay Kumar, IAS, Principal Secretary, Department of Health, Government of Bihar, to chair the session of the day. I request you to please grace the dais. May I now request Stuti Khemani, Senior Economist, the World Bank, to come to the dais. I will now hand over the session to Sri Sanjay Ji to conduct the session. Thank you.
Morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good to see you, Shaivalji. And my colleague, Stuti, who shares the dais with me. I am happy to be here, and I'm also happy that Adri has organized this International Conference on Public Finance, Theory, Practice, and Challenges. It gives a great opportunity for people like us who, there's a word in Hindi, you know, kumar ka mendak. So sometimes you do become a frog in the well. You're working and your concerns become rather limited and you see not much beyond what you get to see while you're sitting in your office. So for us also, it gives us a great opportunity to interact with people from all over the world, share ideas, get acquainted with the kind of vision and what is being done at the forefront of research across the world. So I take this opportunity to welcome all of you. One of my onerous tasks is also to introduce Stuti to you. Stuti Khemani is a senior economist and the development research group of the World Bank. She joined through the Young Professionals Program after obtaining a PhD in economics from MIT. Her area of research is the political economy of public policy choices, institutional reforms for development. She publishes regularly in magazines and journals like American Economic Journal, Journal of Development Economics, American Political Science Review, and she is the lead author of the policy research report, Making Politics Work for Development, Harnessing Transparency and Citizens' Engagement. Currently working on how do you design governance and transparency interventions to build state capacity and strengthen behavioral norms in the public sector. Her research and advisory work spans a diverse range of countries and takes her to disparate countries like Benin, China, India, Philippines, Nigeria, Tanzania, and Uganda. She is going to speak to you on state capacity, which I think is a bread and butter issue for all of us who are part of the government. One of our former prime minister, in a moment of lightness and candidness, admitted that out of every 1 rupee, only 15 paisa reaches the targeted audience. So I guess to a certain extent, some may also depend on the kind of culture, the administrative political culture and the milieu in which we are working. But also, I feel that to a very large extent, it has also to do with state capacity. I'll request Stuti to speak to you and share her ideas and vision, and whatever experience I have garnered on this issue, I would want to and I would love to share with you at the end of the talk. Over to you, Stuti.
It is an honor and a pleasure to be here. I thank Dr. Gupta and everyone at ARDRI for organizing this conference, allowing researchers like myself to share the table with you, people working in research here in India, as well as the policymakers of India. And I thank Mr. Sanjay for taking time out of his schedule to chair this session. My goal today is indeed to share with you a very wide perspective from international research on how to think about this question of state capacity, which very roughly we can think about as when reform leaders who are well-intentioned and want to pursue technically sound public policies, they are faced with the challenge of getting the thousands of personnel that staff a myriad government agencies to deliver. How do we think about that problem? The approach in this paper is going to be a synthesis of very voluminous research that's available. And the exercise is somewhat like building a jigsaw puzzle, but without having the picture to guide you in how to build the puzzle. So what I'm going to argue is the contribution of this paper, and it will be available on a publicly available site. The contribution of this paper is to show what is the big picture which emerges when you fit different pieces of international research in a thoughtful way, including by outlining the missing pieces of the puzzle. So, therefore, pointing us into the direction for future research and distilling already with the available research some new ideas for policymakers for what directions to pursue and why when they are trying to tackle this extremely difficult problem of state capacity. So the framework that I'm going to offer for you to understand, for us to understand what is the problem of state capacity is drawn from a large body of economic theory, and I'm going to show how. So this economic theory has been developed by great men like Jean Tirole and Duatripont, Maskin, and other big economic theorists, and I'm going to show how we can pull together the different theoretical strands and how the empirical evidence, in fact, supports this long-standing theory. So these are the theory of principal-agent relationships, where one type of person, the agent, takes actions on behalf of or at the behest of another, the principal. And the contribution of this way of showing what a complex public sector agency looks like is the interdependency across different types of principal-agent relationships, which so far the literature has analyzed separately from one another. One is the political economy question of the citizen-politician or political leader-principal-agent relationship, but then these political leaders exercise ultimate power over the bureaucracy. So then the second principal-agent relationship is how political leaders delegate power to leaders within the bureaucracy, the public officials. And the third is how the public officials in turn manage thousands of frontline service providers in the public sector. And as I show you examples, I'm going to show how this interdependency and the fact that the agent in one becomes the principal in another really has meaning. Oops, sorry. And again, just to, at the outset, just to set out what is going to come out of all the evidence, which fits the theoretical body of work that we have, there are going to be three channels that matter for how agents with these thousands of state personnel, what their behavior is on the day-to-day work that they do. These three channels, one is incentives, career concerns, what wages you get, whether the salary you get depends upon your performance or not. The second, which is a somewhat neglected area, certainly neglected empirically, although theoretically it has always been a very rich body of work, is on recruitment or selection. So for those of you who have studied modern mainstream economics, you know, it's not just the moral hazard problem of incentives. There's also the problem which we typically learnt as adverse selection, but you can take the word adverse out of it and think about selection of different types. Can you recruit into the public sector types of agents who have greater public service motivation, greater integrity on average than others in the population, or the reverse? And the third, which I think is the most promising area of knowledge, which actually has a lot of bearing on how to bring about change across the world in making the public sector work better, is the issue of norms. Norms are expectations that we have of how others are behaving, which guides our own behavior. So if a society is stuck in a low effort norm, I think my colleagues don't do their work, and so therefore, what is the point of me trying to work? Versus a high effort norm. Everyone around me is taking pride in their work and doing their best, and therefore I must do it too. And this role of norms and peer-to-peer interaction and pressure is going to come out playing a very big role as I continue with this talk. Let me, though, take just a moment to say this is not just a developing country problem. All countries grapple with this very difficult governance challenge. So this is a quote from a classic book on the American bureaucracy by Wilson, and it talks about how government itself is the institutionalization of confusion. The greatest mistake citizens can make when they complain about, quote unquote, the bureaucracy is to suppose that their frustrations arise out of mismanagement. It doesn't. It arises out of real governance problems when citizens and society have to make difficult choices about what is the common public good. One of the things to take away from this talk is I think a model in which we think about development as taking ideas from the rich world to bring to the poor world is absolutely wrong and misguided, and much more so when it comes to this area of governance and state capacity. We are all in it together. So let me begin with some examples in this first principal agent problem between citizens and political leaders to give you a flavor of what direct impact politics has on health service delivery. I'm going to choose health deliberately as an example, but also not only because of the setting here, but also because there happens to be quite a bit of research on it. So this is a result from work I did some time ago in the Philippines. The Philippines is a country where politics is dominated by vote buying at the time of elections. You talk to voters in the Philippines and they actually think politicians offering them money for their vote is a sign of goodwill. It's something they are doing for them, which is legitimate in their eyes. So it wasn't difficult for us to gather data on whether you were offered a sum of money for your vote in local elections. These are local municipal elections in the Philippines, and municipal governments are responsible for delivering basic primary healthcare services. What these two pictures are showing you is the data we gathered shows that in places, barangays or villages in the Philippines, where a larger proportion of household respondents answer affirmatively to the question of vote buying, we see health services being worse. And the measures of health services come from a completely different type of data collection. They come from direct facility records. So one, we find that the municipal government invests less in health as measured by fewer health workers available in the village level public health clinic. And second, the health workers are supposed to maintain a register of child nutrition, where they periodically weigh children and record how many were severely below normal. And we find that in places where village level politics revolved around had more widespread vote buying, a higher proportion of children are recorded as having severely below normal weight. So just, this is not to prove anything, this is just to say this kind of evidence supports a lot of the logical theoretical arguments that are there in these, how the political principal agent relationship affects actual day-to-day service delivery and outcomes. Now, you might think that poor voters can't be trusted. If their votes can be bought, health services are doomed. But this is the flip side of the picture. This is evidenced by my colleague Thomas Fujiwara, who found in Brazil that a reform that allowed, it made it easier for poor and illiterate citizens to cast their vote effectively, it was an electronic voting reform. So people, instead of having to read through a list of names, could see the pictures of their candidates and cast their vote more accurately, resulted in fewer invalid votes in poor areas, so greater effective enfranchisement of poor voters. And that reform was then in turn associated with increase in spending in health, increase in provision of public health inputs and workers to deliver those inputs, and a corresponding improvement in child health outcomes. So vote buying, lack of effective enfranchisement, worse for health, effective enfranchisement of poor people, better for health. So now let's come to the other two principal agent problems, which is what you might typically think of as state capacity, as stuff that happens in the complex bureaucratic organizations of the state. Now, let me take a moment to step away from this incentives norms framework and think a little bit about what I heard all day yesterday in the conference, which to me sounded very much like a production function approach to state capacity. You know, a production function, capital, labor, you put money into the state, you hire people, you build buildings, you equip it, and so, you know, fiscal transfers, if you get the fiscal composition right, capital spending versus developmental spending, you know, that is the policy question. And I want to show you how this approach is really gives a word of caution to the pure fiscal allocation approach to building state capacity. The other area which people put a lot of stock by is technology. Clearly, we live in an era where technological innovations are substantial. And so you can think about technology as embedded in the F, the production function. So if you change technology, you make the F production function more productive for any given level of resources. So I am going to concede that, of course, resources and technology are needed. And in fact, there's a lot of growing research evidence on how technology can be employed to reduce leakage and delays in fund flows and enable better monitoring by higher or mid-level managers in complex organizations over the lower tiers. So in that sense, the Rajiv Gandhi oft-quoted example of how much only 15 paise reaches the ground, that is in, could, if technology is adopted, could in fact no longer be a problem. That's the easy problem. I'll tell you what I think is the hard problem. The hard problem is for services that are human resource intensive, where delivery depends upon the day-to-day behavior of human beings, of teachers and health workers that are hired by the state. So Jeff, my colleague, who gave an excellent presentation yesterday, is a co-conspirator in several of the path-breaking evidence that came out in 2004 around the World Development Report, making services work for poor people. One of them documented worldwide widespread absenteeism among teachers and health workers, and Jeff shared with you some of those examples for India in particular. Furthermore, my colleague Jishnu Das, who sits just a few doors down from me, has a fantastic paper along with several co-authors where they show that doctors in the public sector in India, they perform particularly poorly when seeing patients in their public clinic versus in their own private practice. Sort of irrefutable evidence of a problem of incentives in the public sector in particular. Now, can technology solve this incentive problem? That is sort of the first thing that now both international development partners, as well as my fellow researchers in the randomista movement of running randomized controlled trials, try to do. Well, here's a problem, low incentives, let's use technology and fix it. So smartphones, timestamp machines, biometric scanning devices, all of these have been examined in different RCTs to monitor attendance of frontline public sector workers and see if they can improve them. So here are some of the takeaways that come from a large body of RCTs. These kinds of interventions tend to be only effective in competitive political constituencies. This is a result that came out in Pakistan. Some of these technologies worked in the RCT to reduce absenteeism. This is the Banerjee, Duflo, and Glenester paper. This is in India with ANMs. Putting timestamp machines reduced the absenteeism rate of ANMs. But lo and behold, very soon after this intervention was rolled out, there was an outcry by the frontline health workers. These timestamp machines were vandalized and the reforms were reversed. And the authors conclude in their paper, there was no political will to take up the technology. Another recent paper, also by the Randomista crew, Iqbal Dhaliwal and Reema Hanna, again in India, in the state of Karnataka, worked very closely with the state government to use biometric scanning devices again to address the absenteeism problem. And what they found, one, they just describe an implementation nightmare. It was really hard to get the program implemented, despite the fact that the ideas and the motivation was coming from the very top of the bureaucracy. And furthermore, even the effects they do find suggest that while absenteeism might have reduced, the intervention may have displaced corruption to other forms. Finally, in this Pakistan work that Michael Callan and others have done, they show that doctors with connections to political leaders are more likely to be absent from public health clinics, and the public officials who manage these doctors are more likely to report political interference when trying to apply sanctions. So this is direct evidence of the interdependency between these principal-agent problems that I was talking about. What else does the international development community and my fellow researchers think they can do to tackle this problem? The other very fashionable solution is, let's just get the beneficiaries, the people in the village who depend upon these services, they are the ones who are going to benefit if the health and education services are provided. Why can't they just get together and apply social pressure on the frontline health worker or teacher to deliver? Hence, we have citizen engagement in service delivery, which this World Development Report that I referred to earlier, Making Services Work for Poor People, popularized by calling it the short route to accountability, somehow suggesting that it would be easier to get this done than to raise these very complex political questions. The evidence shows that relying on citizen action in fact has nothing to do with building state capacity. One, unsuccessful cases directly show no impact. So I was myself involved in the first of this kind of evaluation with MIT's JPAL, the Abdul Latif Jameel Poverty Action Lab. We did an experiment in Uttar Pradesh where we tried to activate the village education committees, which at baseline, nobody knew existed. 3% of respondents had ever heard of the VEC. And interestingly, 20% of of parent members who were supposed to be on the VEC didn't know there was such a thing as VEC. So we did a series of mobilization campaigns working with the agency Pratham in Uttar Pradesh. And what we found that these campaigns did have an effect. The effect they had is young people in the village got energized, got trained by Pratham, and held private reading classes outside the school. And the children who attended those reading classes made dramatic strides in going from not being able to recognize letters and words to being able to read short stories. But nothing changed in the public delivery system. So what some researchers have estimated to be $1.5 billion of annual wastage due to teachers being on the public payroll and not showing up, that problem was not affected by this citizen engagement campaign. Successful cases, such as one in Uganda, which has been used by international development partners to push for so-called social accountability everywhere, cannot actually show that any impact happened because the state was able to perform better. A range of evidence from Indonesia, I'm just giving you some tidbits here. Range of evidence from Indonesia suggests what we know from the work of Manker Olson and others well before this, that it's easy to get people to mobilize when their own private benefits are at stake, like subsidized rice in Indonesia, like their personal wage payments in workfare programs in Indonesia. It's very hard to mobilize them for public goods for which the benefits are widely shared. And for things like health and education, this is a real conundrum. The one of the big rationales for state provision of health and education is precisely to reach those children whose parents are severely constrained and are unable to invest in their own children. Then to expect these same parents to somehow be able to engage for all children's well-being, there's some logical inconsistency here. But anyway, the reading of the evidence, and you can find all of this in the policy research report that Mr. Sanjay ji mentioned earlier, there is just no evidence that logically or empirically this is the path to state capacity. So what does the theory say? So I mentioned that this body of economic theory, which uses logic, all the examples I've given you so far, suggests that the empirical evidence is entirely consistent with the logic of that theory. So now let's pursue that logic a little bit further. Where does it lead us? What does it say about how complex organizations should be managed? Well, one set of insights that come out are actually shared by complex organizations anywhere, public and private. And that is the value of giving autonomy. Rather than looking over people's shoulders and making sure that no corruption is happening, you give autonomy, along with a role for peer-to-peer monitoring and intrinsic motivation to have integrity, to perform your job well, professional norms. The public sector also differs in significant ways, and this yields additional insights. One is, again, the importance of selecting types, people who have a motivation to bring about well-being in society. Second difference in public sector organization is it's much harder to measure outcomes or the bottom line and attribute it to particular actions of particular agents. Public sector organizations have to work in teams, and there is no profit or loss bottom line. Third is the role of the political process through which leaders are selected and sanctioned. And I'm not talking about the high national level. I'm in fact would like you to think about the very humble village level with the first mile of political contestation. I won't have time today to go through reams and reams of literature, but it is there in the paper, which will be available. A lot of the evidence on how political institutions cast a long shadow on the day-to-day functioning of complex public sector organizations, in fact, comes from history. So there's a lot of work on persistent effect of historical institutions, long since those institutions have been removed. Within Italy, there's one body of work that compares differences across North and South Italy. There's a body of work in comparing Latin America to the US. And all of this, there's a body of work on East Asia, China, Vietnam. All of this work suggests that the reason historical institutions have persistence is because politics is the arena where people form expectations of how others are thinking in the public sphere. And it is through those expectations or norms that politics has this day-to-day and persistent effects on how people behave in their job, even if they are not directly connected with elections or so. Again, just to summarize, so the first of what are these two insights from theories? Reduced role of high-powered incentives, where wages are dependent, incremental wages are dependent upon incremental improvements in performance, and greater role for recruiting intrinsically motivated agents. Two quick examples of this. One, a study in India that several authors did in Karnataka, where they find that the impact of financial incentives to rural doctors, its impact in improving maternal and child health depends upon the doctor's behavioral traits. Second is work I'm engaged in Uganda with co-authors, where we gathered data from the Ministry of Health on the ministry's own ratings of district-level governments in implementing national health programs. And we gathered very rich data to try to examine what are the determinants of variation in implementation by these district governments. Three things stand out. The one that I'm going to focus on right now are the integrity of these very humble, locally elected politicians. Think the ward member or the mukhya in gram panchayats in our context. So where locally elected politicians have higher integrity, health delivery was better. The other two variables that were very robust was the presence of local radio and the vote share of the president's party. But I won't have time to get into that. The second implication that comes out of the theory is the reduced role for top-down hierarchical monitoring and greater role for autonomy and peer-to-peer professional norms. And evidence for this comes from Nigeria, that when project capital construction, project implementation is delegated to agencies with greater autonomy, then outcomes are better. Finally, just to stick with this importance of professional norms, no developed country in the world relies on closely monitoring professionals like teachers and doctors to achieve high levels of health service delivery and education service delivery. So this, in the business of international development, our search for quick solutions which can be shown to work in an RCT, like technology, cameras to monitor teacher attendance, or biometric scanning devices, these can be theoretically at least detrimental to the development of professional norms. This classic work on American bureaucracy that I quoted from at the beginning highlights that well-functioning public agencies, and Wilson gives three types of very different examples, prisons, armies, and schools. What is common across them is they are led by people who manage the professionals serving under them to take pride in their work and do their jobs well. So case studies of how these professional bureaucracies came about in places like the United States and the United Kingdom give us further historical evidence on the importance of the intricate relationship of politics with the professional norms in the bureaucracy. So the United States had the same type of vote buying like I described to you in the Philippines. Lots of colorful quotes about how politics revolved around giving a shot of whiskey or a pair of boots in exchange for votes. That country, with those very similar initial conditions between the turn of the 19th to the 20th century, there was a large social movement called the Progressive Eras Movement, where the notion of professionalism of certain types of tasks and agencies like doctors and teachers came into being. And that sense of professional pride and the demand of the mass electorate, both poor and business interest elites, created a demand for state capacity to deliver urban public health services. And the spread of newspapers that revealed widespread corruption, that allowed people to evaluate political leaders on performance basis, all of that in this case studies describe how this shift in the processes of political contestation away from private vote buying type politics to broader public interest demands is what was credited with the development of the professional bureaucracy. But let's look at one example that may be closer to home in a sense. This is the case study of the state of Ceará in Brazil. In the 1990s, it made headlines. New York Times has articles covering it, and Judith Tendler, a professor at MIT in the political science department, gave a very nice case study of what happened in Ceará. So these reform-minded governors took office and were faced with really difficult conditions. The state is a tradition, it's in the northeast of Brazil, it's one of the poorer states, so they were faced with poverty and a recent drought. They had some of the highest infant mortality rates in the world. Very few health workers who were delivering vaccines. Municipalities were embroiled in patronage politics. Mayors controlled the position of the health supervisors who would be overseeing the work of any low-level health cadre delivering vaccines. So the reform-minded governor was not sure that if he spent money on health, then these health cadres were going to deliver because of the patronage politics at the lower level. So what did the reformer do? He did two things simultaneously on the so-called supply and demand side. He engaged in a large-scale meritocratic recruitment of a new cadre of health workers. Second, he engaged in a media blitz. Radio was the media at the time, a massive communication campaign, not about take your child to get a vaccination, not your eradicate polio campaign. This was a campaign which communicated the value of a public health system, the value of having this new cadre of health workers, and the role of the local mayors in giving this new cadre the appropriate space to do their job. And Judith Tendler puts together lots of qualitative evidence and suggests that this supply and demand side approach did succeed in building an effective public health system, not only in the state of Ceará, but in fact became the blueprint for Brazil's national family health program. And in Ceará in particular, these efforts within the span of a few years dramatically reduced infant mortality. Ceará is in the news again today. One of the recent World Development Reports on Education has taken education tourism to the municipality of Sobral in Ceará, where lots of turnarounds have happened from very poor education service delivery to remarkably good quality now. Lots of interviews, again, New York Times, interviewing the mayor of Sobral. So what did the mayor of Sobral say? Happened? What works in education? Well, what works is having a set of committed teachers who take pride in the profession of teaching. And what he said was the problem was that teachers did not have this sense of professionalism because they were political appointees. So this new mayor made education quality politically salient in the local area. He created conditions for reducing political interference in the appointment of school head teachers, and at the same time, using his position as a local political leader, he supported professional development among the teachers through peer-to-peer interaction. So to summarize, if norms are so important and we believe the theory and where it takes us, how do professional norms come about? Well, again, the theory on norms says that when norms are weak or even perverse to start with, there is a role for communication to shift expectations about how others are behaving. Data and innovation are needed not only for technical changes in that production function approach, although that is important, but also to feed complementary communication campaigns. So for example, this is just thinking off the top of one's head after reviewing all of this international evidence. What are some examples that we might want to think about in the context here today? Perhaps new ideas for infusing data and information about the value of public health in peer meetings among the cadres in a state, such as WhatsApp groups of ANMs. In the local media that actually a large base of citizens consume, such as the Hindi newspapers that enjoy tremendous circulation in a state like Bihar. All of this as a complement to any other type of technical supply side reforms of performance-based contracts with agents. Furthermore, design of any performance-based contract can and its impact may very well depend upon the existence of this complementary communication campaign that shifts the quality of village-level politics. Think about all the examples I've been giving you. Philippines, Uganda, Pakistan, where these humble local political leaders really matter. And so I'll just finish. I don't even know if I've run out of time. Okay, so these are just a list of my what I hope you would take away from this. Certainly resources, design of fiscal transfers, technology are important, but something else is really at the crux of the problem, and this is the problem of incentives and professional norms. Persistently weak incentives and low performance norms in any system can be thought of as a zero-sum game being played out within political institutions, where everyone thinks everyone else is out to extract private benefits from public resources. When this zero-sum game is being played out, there is no real blueprint. There is no knowledge in the external world that can be brought and placed somewhere else. The entire world is in a joint search for solutions. The best international agencies can do is exercise our technical comparative advantage in bringing big data and drawing some meaningful information out of that big data through empirical analysis. Communication campaigns are a necessary complement, even if one type of design may not work. You have to go back to the drawing board and try again to try to move from this zero-sum game to a positive-sum game. And let me just end on at least a note that inspires me. We are standing here in Patna, which has a glorious history. When Megasthenes visited Patna during the Maurya period, he said it was one of the most effectively governed cities in the world. It's also a place where the Buddhist city-states of Vaishali had all of these norms we are talking about, was a positive sum game being played out among citizens. So this is a history that is shared in this place that we are standing, and there is no reason to think this is unachievable. We just have to think about the problem differently. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Excellent presentation, Stuti. It was a delight listening to you, and I guess it brought back many of the issues which we are grappling with on a daily basis. Some commonsensical, and I guess to put it in a theoretical framework, I guess that makes things more understandable. I don't know, I've just been thinking that what is the interface between the political, the principal agents and people like you who are part of academics and who are doing research? I don't know if the principal agents and the academicians are coming together to for some kind of an interaction, because what you're doing, people must be aware of that. I mean, I don't know, the ministers may see it, the MLAs may like to see it. Before I throw questions, I ask you to ask questions or raise any important observation. I would want to say that one of my very important thing which I always love to quote is that Jim Grant used to be the executive director of UNICEF in mid-80s. And I read a biography and people wrote about him that for the next 50 years, Jim Grant's primary preoccupation was that morality must march with capacity. and I guess morality in the sense that many of us in the government, we have great intentions, we want to do good things, and we often begin with good intentions, but since we don't create commensurate capacity in a sustainable manner, more often than not, it's like a flash in the pan. You do something, and then maybe after 6 months' time or 1 year's time, we start doing something else, it doesn't quite sustain. A lot of things can be said, but may I ask if any of you have any question or an observation which you may want to raise to the House, or maybe ask Stuti about it. Would request you to kindly introduce yourself so we know who you are and then ask the question or observation.
Thanks for the excellent presentation, Stuti. I am from ICIT International. I work on climate-related issues. So my, observation / question is, biased towards that angle. For effective health delivery systems, while, the issues you talk about are very important to address, but disasters also impact, the quality and also the extent of health delivery systems. Especially in UP, the case you were referring to, I have seen areas, clinics, PHCs, CHCs, which are inundated, the roads to the clinics are inundated for days at a stretch, for weeks at a stretch. So my point is, and also, when inundation happens, it also impacts the electricity system, power system, which if fails, conks off the refrigeration system for keeping medicines. So the solutions, part of the solutions, my emphasis is, part of the solutions lie outside the health sector, roads, or electricity, energy, power sector. And there are linkages with other allied sectors. So those need also to be looked into when we are talking about strengthening health system delivery.
Hello. Hi, Stuti. Congratulations for this wonderful presentation. But I'm Vikas. I work at a Center for Health Policy. We have met. And so my basic question, I am from a medical background, venturing into public health and health policy. And so when you started your presentation, I had this understanding that when you talk about stake, you talk about legislators, bureaucrats. But then while presenting, you went up to the ANMs and the lowest level of government. So why, when talking about or proposing about building the capacity, I think more focus goes on to build the capacity at lower level, probably lesser at higher level. So why, do you have any idea, or do you want to propose a method by which, or from where we should start? Should it, this be bottom up or top down? If we are talking about building capacity of the state, especially in health sector, so at which level the capacity building should start? What is there any evidence on that which has worked? Because you have given example from Brazil, where mayor took initiative, so it was a top down. Means mayor's capacity was good, and he started a reform. Similarly, if we have an example like where top bottom up capacity building started in world, because that is probably the approach being taken in most of Indian states.
Hi, yes, my name is Kasturi. I'm from Wolfson College, Oxford, and I advise the Oxford Policy Management Group on health sector in Bihar. I just wanted to make a general observation based on the issue of morality that you raised. Historically speaking, the countries which have been most successful in health outcomes with very low resources have been Costa Rica, Cuba, even Kerala, Thailand and Tanzania. And I think the overriding factor in the success of these countries were low levels of investment per capita, but with a very strong public mission and vision, which seeped down throughout from the top to the bottom. of the health services. So it wasn't really a question of incentives or performance, but having a coherent policy and encouraging a public mission and vision which relates to the morality and to ethics. And I think that that is probably one of the biggest challenges that we are facing in India. I mean, the lack of medical ethics. And perhaps even a culture of commercialization which overrides public service. So I think that it's an observation which I'd like some comments on from you. Thanks.
I'm Arindam Das Gupta from the Goa Institute of Management. I have a very broad and general question. As you pointed out during your presentation, in all these principal agent relationships, it's vital to have the right incentives, among other things. Well, incentives consist of carrots and sticks. I don't recall you having mentioned a single example of a stick in discussing incentives. Could you please elaborate a little bit?
We'll take one more question and then we will ask the strategy to respond. Myself is Ranjit Patnaik. Currently I'm teaching in SPZN, but 26, 27 years I was with the Central Bank, Reserve Bank of India. I want a clarification, state capacity, whether the and the fiscal capacity. You have mentioned about fiscal transfer. So state, how do you differentiate fiscal capacity with state capacity? This is a macro level question. You have a macro aspect as a micro aspect. So the state capacity and fiscal capacity and the needs, because the expenditure responsibility for Indian states according to constitution is very high, much higher than the central government. So the capacity needs, state capacity and fiscal capacity. Could you please throw some light, or it is, can you do that? Thank you.
Well, thank you everyone for all of these great questions, and to Sanjay ji for his remarks as well. It's not? Okay, sorry. Yeah, there? Okay. I'm going to take it in no particular order as it strikes me. So Arindam's question on sticks versus carrots, I think what I was trying to, the main takeaway I was trying to bring out, that if you look at the review of Avinash Dikshit has a great 2002 Journal of Human Resources paper reviewing the theoretical work on what is different about the principal agent problem in complex public sector organizations. And the conclusions are what I showed, that not to rely on high-powered incentives, but instead to rely on all of this intrinsic motivation, peer-to-peer interaction. But a basic stick where, you know, I don't think there's a clear trade-off between incentives and norms. You need the basic stick of, if you don't show up to work, your job is at risk. Let me give you the example of two of the highest performing education systems in the world year after year, Korea and Finland. Lots of detailed case studies on them. These are teachers that do have a lot of job security, very few sticks. But they are teachers, the teaching profession in these countries is highly valued. Top quality candidates become teachers, they receive very high salaries, and it is a system in which if they don't perform, they will face peer censure as well as real risk of getting fired. So it's not as though the incentives, the stick is not there, but in equilibrium, if it's a well-functioning system, you don't expect it to be applied. On Mr. Patnaik's question about fiscal capacity, you actually made a very good observation. A lot of the macro work on state capacity that has recently come up, Tim Besley's work, for example, in fact uses that as a measure, taxation, tax revenues, as a measure of state capacity. And the basic observation is that how countries build fiscal capacity through history is because of the threat of war. So parliamentary democracies in Europe, that is how fiscal capacity came out there, the need to finance the war. I don't find this, I mean, I learn a lot from Tim Besley's work, but I don't think we can draw a direct insight from there for, I think, what you have in mind when you talk about fiscal capacity. I think the way, the ability, the capacity of the state in India to be able to raise domestic revenues, resources, in fact, links to another paper that was presented yesterday on trust. On the role of trust in getting citizen compliance and willingness to contribute to public goods. How do you get progressive taxation in India? And I do think there is a role for greater communication to make public goods available to the poorest citizens of India as a way of, communication to show, I mean, I think there's a dilemma that reform leaders face in the government. They want to do good, but they are stuck in this chicken and egg problem where if it's a low trust state, no one expects, and there's widespread cynicism, no one expects them to do well, hence no one wants to pay taxes. How do you get out of that? And in again, if we apply the game theoretic lens, a persuasive communication campaign is a complement to any other technical strategy that we might come up with. On the question, the first question on infrastructure and resources, all I can say is yes, of course, I completely agree. We need resources, but how do we get there when we are stuck in the zero-sum game? How do we, any service delivery, how do we get effectiveness? But I'll stop there, I've run out of time.
Can I take a minute to sum up?
Yeah, sure.
Just very few quick observations. Capacity to a certain extent, it also means how capable the government is. Often we are told that the government in India has become very large. If you look at the figures, I think these are old World Bank figures. For OECD, out of every 100, 6.1 people are a part of the government, including local bodies. All Asia figure is 2.1. All India figures are 1.6. So what is happening, I guess, and that also out of 1.6, almost about 90% of the people are part of class 3 and class 4. So in a knowledge-based economy, if we are going to have such understaffing and emasculation of manpower, I guess it's going to have long-term effect on the state. Second is that often we feel that technology can supplant your behavioral issues, which doesn't happen. Technology helps, but beyond a point, you need to actually introspect and see what we can do for your behavioral and the kind of expectations we have from joining the state services. Often what happens is that our motivations are very different than just providing services to people. The last and important point which I would want to make and also request Adri and people who are here that maybe we can do some research on it, because often what happens is that an institution responds to the kind of demand which is placed on it. Let me just say, when I used to be district magistrate almost about 14 years back, and I used to ask myself that what is the kind of demand which is coming to me, I often found that most of the demands which were being placed on my office were personal in nature. People wanted a PDS license, people wanted an arms license, they wanted to be transferred from place A to B. So there was no collective demand being placed on the office. I did not come across anyone coming and telling me that why is the dropout rate from primary to secondary school so high? Can we do something about it? Now I'm the principal secretary of health, and every time the assembly is in session, we take questions which are raised by the honorable MLAs and we answer them. I guess it will be very instructive if one or some of you can take this opportunity to actually take these questions in the last 5 sessions or 10 sessions, and you make a summary of it to see the kind of demand which is being placed on the department via the system of the legislature. I think it will be very instructive. Again, I find that they are very personal in nature. Probably a lot of it are contract driven, that this construction must take place, that construction must take place. Again, collective demands are not being placed on the office. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for a very interesting talk, and thank you, sir, for summing it up also. I request Dr. Sunita Lal to please hand out token of gift to our delegates.
Thank you.
sir. You'll be called again.